For more than 100 years, the name Louis Vuitton has been world famous for its luxury travel goods and accessories. The iconic monogram canvas is considered the very first designer label to appear on a product, and Vuitton's signature leather goods are a status symbol around the globe. But over the past few years, the brand has been broadening its scope and making an impression on the catwalk thanks to the vision and expertise of artistic director and fashion designer Marc Jacobs. He launched Louis Vuitton's first prêt-à-porter clothing line in 1997. Since then, the brand has successfully cultivated a celebrity following, with stars like Uma Thurman and Scarlett Johansson, along with models Gisele Bündchen and Kate Moss, appearing in commercials. Louis Vuitton's menswear and accessories is also developing a strong following for its dedication to luxury and comfort. Marc Jacobs' most recent autumn-winter collection included chinchilla earmuffs, cashmere gloves and mink hats. The entire collection had an opulent feel to it, with hooded anoraks and fur-lined parkas, worn with steel-capped industrial boots and fur scarves. The slimline silhouette accented the waist and narrow leg trousers. Born in New York, Marc Jacobs designed and sold his first line of hand-knitted sweaters while still at design college. In 1986, he released his first collection under the Marc Jacobs label, and the next year he became the youngest designer ever to win the coveted Perry Ellis Award for New Fashion Talent. In 1992, the Council of Fashion Designers of America declared him the Women's Designer of the Year. Since being seconded to Louis Vuitton, he's commissioned artists such as Steven Sprouse and Takashi Murakami to help revamp the brand's signature products. His own clothing lines, Marc Jacobs and the less expensive Marc, are known for refusing to follow seasonal trends and are sometimes less popular with the fashion critics than they are with his buying public.
Beautiful combinations. I mean, some cotton fabrics that looked like techno fabrics, some actual silks that were, you know, again, quite technical, but actually silk. Some beautiful alpacas that looked kind of like teddy bears, like furs, but they were alpacas and mohairs, and some touches of fur and sheepskin, glazed cottons, different things. But yeah, very, again, a lot of restraint, very specific fabrication choices, very specific color palette of blacks and grays and stones, beiges.
For the highly label-conscious, large LV monochrome logos were carefully placed on the breast of waistcoats, on the back of selected coats, and of course, on the accessories and bags.
There were very specific and, I would say, considered choices made in every proportion cut. Some of the jackets were in, like, kind of inside out, and so there was a label apparent or a logo apparent. There was little enamel pins. I mean, there were many touches and details, some more clear to see. I mean, some of them you probably wouldn't even see if you were sitting right there, but they were all there because those are the things that we feel make our clothes luxurious.
Something a little less this season, but no less luxurious, is the black dress worn by Audrey Hepburn during the opening scene of the movie Breakfast at Tiffany's, which was unveiled in New York ahead of auction.
Let's work for UNICEF. So the dress, it's certainly one of the most iconic moments in film history, that scene outside Tiffany's in the early hours of the morning with Holly Golightly eating out of a paper bag. It's up there in important moments in cinematic history with Marilyn Monroe standing over the subway grate in The 7-Year Itch.
The dress, designed by French designer Hubert de Givenchy for the film in 1961, was modelled for the media at Tiffany & Company's flagship store in New York, where Hepburn wore the dress in the actual movie. Christie's spokesperson Helen Bailey said the dress is one of three designed by Givenchy for the film. The dress was donated in support of the charity City of Joy Aid to raise money for the impoverished in India. The estimated value of the dress is between $94,000 and $132,000.
Dresses are still around today. According to Givenchy, this was not the one worn in the film, but there are three dresses. One is in the Costume Museum in Madrid, and one is in Givenchy's own personal archives in Paris. This is the only dress that will ever come on the market, and we at Christie's are truly excited and very honoured. The dress has been donated and is being sold on behalf of City of Joy Aid. City of Joy Aid is a charity that was started by a gentleman called Dominic Lapierre. He actually worked in the slums of Calcutta with Mother Teresa and was inspired to set up his charity, which raises money for families living in poverty in the slums in India. So we're very honoured as well that Givenchy has donated it for this worthy cause, and he feels that that is truly in the spirit of Audrey Hepburn herself after her fabulous work for UNICEF.
The daughter of a Dutch aristocrat and descended from French nobility, Audrey Hepburn grew up under Nazi rule during the Second World War. Proficient as a ballet dancer, she secretly danced for people in private to raise money for resistance groups. Too tall to become a ballerina, she moved to acting, and her starring role alongside Gregory Peck in Roman Holiday confirmed her as a star. Breakfast at Tiffany's, My Fair Lady, and a string of successes followed. But she turned her back on her career in the 1970s to serve as a UNICEF Goodwill Ambassador. Despite her early retirement, she's ranked by the American Film Institute as the third greatest female film star of all time. Coming up, the Governor's Ball. Star of Dark Angel and Sin City also lent her celebrity power to the occasion, appropriately dressed in gold. Rap artist Ludacris also came in his penguin.